All right, so I wanted to let you guys know that I did some reconnaissance work before we all arrived last night. And so what I have is pictures of all of your bathrooms. And I made sure to get some close-ups of all of your toilets and all of your showers. So if you ladies can actually look up at the screens with me. I'm just kidding. I promise you, ladies, I don't have any such photos. I don't desire to have any such photos of your bathrooms. But if you are like me, you may have started to get a little nervous, a little sweat around the forehead and the small of the back. And the sad thing is, I think this is how many of us feel when we start to approach the topic that I have been privileged enough to talk about today, and that's scripture memorization. Sometimes when we show up to hear about this necessary but often overlooked spiritual discipline, we can start to feel like we've just invited someone in to look at our bathroom shower. But that is really the last way that I want us to view these next 20 minutes. And so I wanted to start by sharing with you guys something that I heard from a pastor very recently. And what he did was he encouraged his listeners to never confuse the words enough and more. You see, when it comes to our faith, the word enough should only be used when talking about Christ as our means of justification, which is our right standing before God. This means understanding that we will never be enough and that we can never do enough in any realm of our Christian walk. Now, it is Christ alone that is enough for us to be fully justified before a holy God. But rather, when we get together and we talk about our sanctification, which is the process of us being made more into the image of Christ, we should use the word more, because that is the word that Scripture uses. So Paul commended both the Philippian and Thessalonian churches for their love and obedience, and yet he urged them to do so more and more. And so as Christian women here this morning, we need to start by all humbly realizing that we will never memorize enough Scripture. But we are all called to memorize more and more. So the great thing is, whether you're sitting here this morning and you have never memorized Scripture, or you have pages of Scripture written on your heart, we're actually all in the exact same boat this morning. Because no matter what, we're all called this morning to memorize more and more Scripture. And I want to spend the bulk of our time this morning talking about why we do this, with less being devoted to the how. May seem odd, but just bear with me. And as we look at the why, there's one passage that I want us all to set our eyes with. So if you have your Bibles, and you can open up to Psalm 119 for me. And I do promise that we will address some of the very practical how-tos. But before we do that, we are going to make sure that we equally understand the very practical why. Because let's be honest, I could spend the morning teaching you all how to cook beef liver, but if you don't actually want to eat beef liver, then I've just kind of wasted my time. So, all right, if you're at Psalm 119, we are going to be looking at verse 11. So go ahead and get your eyes there while I read it aloud. David says, "I have stored up your word in my heart that I might not sin against you." This verse makes our why incredibly clear. We are directed by God to store up his word so that we will be equipped to fight sin. Now, the Hebrew word used in this verse for stored up implies that something of great value is being stored. This is pretty neat as we think about Holly's message last night, because this word is actually translated in other passages to mean treasured. And so we can clearly see, like we learned last night, God's word is a treasure, but it also needs to be treasured within us. And so I want us to write down point number one as this: understand the importance of treasuring up God's word in your heart. Understand the importance of treasuring up God's word in your heart. Our verse talks about storing up or treasuring God's word in our hearts. So I want to look at that word for just a minute. That Hebrew word is really talking about the seat of all of our emotion, our desire, our thoughts, and our decisions. So it's really the idea of the whole source of our inner person. And Scripture teaches us that many things can fill up or dwell within our hearts. Things like pride, pain, idols, as well as things like wisdom, joy, and the word of God, like we see in our passage. So the question is never going to be whether or not we are filling up our hearts, but the question is going to be, what are we filling up our hearts with? And the answer to this question is what's going to determine whether or not we are setting ourselves up to give into temptation each day, or whether or not we are setting ourselves up to be delivered from temptation. Because each and every day is a battlefield, and the war is over our holiness and the glory of our Savior. But I'm afraid that too often we wake up and we're so consumed with our to-do list and really just the urgent nature of our day that we can forget we're in a battle at all. And the problem is, if we don't think we're at war, well, then why would we dress with our only offensive weapon, which is the sword of the Spirit? And so we don't. But failing to dress for battle doesn't erase the reality of the battle. It reminds me of the classic story, The Emperor's New Groove. Or The Emperor's New Clothes, sorry. That's my kid's favorite, is The Emperor's New Groove. The Emperor's New Clothes, right? This emperor was convinced that he was exquisitely dressed, but it did not change the reality that he was naked. And I think too many times we are showing up naked in the spiritual sense. We don't tend to notice, unfortunately, that we are underdressed until our temptations are burdening us so heavily that we feel as though there is no way out. It makes me think of the dishes in our home. So like Holly mentioned, we have 7 people in our home right now, which means that we use a lot of dishes when we eat. And so it only takes about 2 to 3 meals for us to really load up our dishwasher. And that doesn't include hand washing that has to be done after each meal. Now, if the kids and I stay on top of this, it's really manageable. It's really easy. But, you know, if we think, we can skip this one meal, it's not really that big of a deal. You know, it doesn't take much for those dishes to very quickly pile up. And what could have been addressed in 10 to 15 minutes now seems like a huge task, and sometimes seems like a task that's even too big for me to tackle. The same situation is happening in each and every one of our lives every single day, only I fear it's not the dishes piling up, but it's those little acceptable sins. The anger that rises in your heart when your child disobeys you. The frustration you feel when your husband doesn't respond the way you wanted him to. How about the worry and fear that grips you as you hear another news headline or the gossip that just falls off your lips in whispered tones at your office or your school? Now, none of these examples come out of nowhere in our lives because, ladies, we are never a victim of our sin. James tells us in chapter 1, verses 14 through 15, that each person is tempted when he is lured and enticed by his own desire. Then desire, when it has conceived, gives birth to sin, and sin, when it is fully grown, brings forth death. We can see in this passage that there is a step between our initial temptation and our actual sin. This is the vital stage where we will either choose to give in to our temptation or be delivered from our temptations. And this is the stage where we must turn to the Word to be delivered. Training ourselves to go immediately to Scripture in these moments is what's going to protect us from having the dishes pile up, so to speak. Now, this is a principle that we see echoed throughout Scripture, and I want us to hear just a few of these verses this morning because I want to make sure we understand the connection that God Himself makes between us treasuring up His Word in our hearts and us living holy and God-honoring lives. Psalm 37:31 says, "The law of His God is in His heart. His steps do not slip." Psalm 40, verse 8 says, "I delight to do your will, O my God. Your law is within my heart." And Deuteronomy 30, verse 14 says, "But the word is very near to you. It is in your mouth and in your heart so that you can do it." James also tells us that the word of God is like a mirror that we can look into and see a clear reflection of what's out of place in our hearts and lives. And like Holly shared last night from Hebrews 4:12, we know that the word of God is living and active, sharper than any two-edged sword, piercing to the division of soul and of spirit, of joints and of marrow, and discerning the thoughts and intentions of the heart. Treasuring God's word helps us to see our sin for what it is and turn from it using the power of His word to be delivered from our temptations. Now, I want to look at a few very realistic, everyday examples of what this looks like because I want to make sure this morning we're taking the why from a very general principle and we are putting it into our everyday lives so we see this touches us. I want to start by talking about unholy and impure thoughts. This can cover really any number of thought patterns that are displeasing to God, but I want to focus for a moment on lustful thoughts. This is a temptation that mostly gets attributed to men, and because of that, I fear that there are far too many women walking around with tolerated thoughts that have become acceptable sins. Now, perhaps this comes in the form of past sins. Maybe you would have a similar testimony to mine where you didn't get saved until you were older. And so sometimes for no reason at all, I can have flashes and memories just pop into my mind that have to be addressed. Maybe this comes in the form of you watching television or shows. There's an actor you think is particularly good looking and you know, you've allowed yourself to look a little longer than you ought to because he's just an actor. But we have to remember what Jesus said. He said, "But I say to you that everyone who looks at a woman or a man with lustful intent has already committed adultery with her in his heart." Maybe it's simpler than that, right? The guy who made you your latte this morning, or your friend's husband who's more affectionate or romantic or fill in the blank than your own. When these thoughts find their way into our minds, we must act. We must use God's word to fight back against the temptation to allow these unholy thoughts to take up residence in our minds, because ladies, these temptations do not have to become sin. Now, how about anger? You get cut off while you're driving. Your child refuses to listen to you in the grocery store, right? Someone has spoken poorly of you or gossiped about you. Your expectations just haven't been met. Something spilled, something broke. I mean, all of these are phenomenal catalysts for anger. But before sin sets in, at the moment of incident, this is where we must take action with the word. Now, what if I mention things like fear, anxiety, depression? Maybe these strike a painful chord with you as you sit here this morning. And let me be really clear. I am very sensitive to the fact that we all live in broken vessels. Our bodies just don't work as they ought to. And anyone that has ever shared a meal with me knows that I have my own brokenness I need to steward over, and that affects how I eat. But even when there is physical brokenness present that needs to be addressed, there is always a spiritual root that can and should be tackled first. I reminded of the ancient Egyptians who would mummify their pharaohs to prepare them for the afterlife. Now, they actually believed at that time that the heart was the physical origin of all thought. And so when preparing the pharaohs, they would actually remove their brains but keep their hearts in their bodies. Now, we hear this and this seems kind of foolish because we now know all that the brain is capable of and all that it does. But I wonder how many times you and I look awfully foolish to the Lord as we attempt to solve problems of the soul by addressing only the body. Because it's important to note that even when physical brokenness is present, a satisfied soul is always possible. And most times, the soul that is satisfied in God and in his word is itself rescued from fear and depression and anxiety. And even in those cases where the physical brokenness needs to be addressed, the process of waiting can be one of joy and not despair when we trust God's word to do its work in our hearts and minds. Now, perhaps gossip has become an acceptable sin between you and your sister or your close friend or your husband. Now, you wouldn't use that word per se, but you might find yourself venting quite frequently when someone has hurt or irritated or shocked you. As the Proverbs say, you find yourself enjoying those morsels of whispers shared between you and a close friend or a spouse. Now, whether or not we have come to accept this kind of talk as normal in our lives, God's word clearly teaches us otherwise. We do not have the right to use our speech for any unkindness towards another. Now, maybe you're sitting here this morning and you're just tired. But the kind of tiredness that whispers in your ear each and every day that you just can't do it all. God's calling is just too high. His commandments are too burdensome for you. You know, if only he understood all that you had on your plate. Well, then how could he expect you to also spend time with him and his people? How could he expect you to live holy lives and actually fight sin? You just don't feel like you have the energy to do it. Now, as relatable as these thoughts may be for you this morning, they're wrong. They are sinful. They express a belief that God has left us alone to pull up our own bootstraps, rather than the reality of his nearness that pushes us to fully rely on him and his energy to carry us through all that he has called us to do. Now, there are still many examples that we could discuss together this morning, but I am hopeful that even this short list shows each and every one of us that we are in a very real battle against sin, and we are facing that battle each and every day. So now that we really understand the gravity of why we need to treasure up Scripture in our hearts, I want to quickly look at how we are to do that. So for point number two, please write down, learn how to treasure up God's Word in your heart. Now, I want us to look at this as a three-step process, and we're going to use the word dig. Each letter in our acronym will equip us to dig for treasures in God's Word that we're going to need to fight our everyday temptations. So we are going to start by looking at letter D, which stands for discover. The first step is to identify the temptations that we are currently facing in our lives so that we can mine through the Scriptures to discover the passage or passages that will best equip us to battle those temptations. And it's important to understand this is not simply about finding helpful passages. It's first and foremost about knowing ourselves. Like we talked about earlier, we need to be looking into the mirror of God's Word so that we can find what is out of place in our hearts and minds. Now, this can be especially tricky if we have gotten used to tolerating what we view as acceptable sins for a long time and we've become self-deceived by our own wicked flesh. But if this is the case, we can start by praying Psalm 139, 23 through 24, which says, "Search me, O God, and know my heart. Try me and know my thoughts, and see if there be any grievous way in me, and lead me in the way everlasting." We know that God is faithful to answer our prayers that are aligned with his will, and we can be confident that our holiness as believers is in line with the will of God. So as we seek to discover these hidden sins, we need to trust that God is going to be faithful to reveal them to us. And then when he does, we need to be ready to turn to the Word to find the appropriate treasures to really help us with those greatest temptations. Now, it might be helpful in this first step to even seek out the help of another believer, someone who knows the Word really well. They can help you. They can give you suggestions for where to start if you're not sure. Another option is you could use a website like blueletterbible.org. It just has free Bible study tools, so you could do a keyword search really easily there. That's blueletterbible.org. Your Bible concordance is very similar in that way, and you can do look up there. The goal ultimately is finding Scripture that will uniquely combat our temptations. So really my encouragement would be use whatever resources you have to do that. Now our next step, is simple, yet it cannot be overstated enough. We need to, letter I, implore. I think many of us in this room, if not all of us, would say that we are not naturally great at memorizing. If we're being honest, it's very hard to do. Even with practice and methods and strategies, it is still a grind. And so we need to make sure that what we are relying most on is the Lord. And we need to do that through prayer. Because if we're relying completely on a really cool app or an index card system to memorize God's Word, we're going to struggle and we're going to feel like we're failing. We need to go to the one who gives wisdom. We need to go to the one who created our minds and has full sovereign authority over them. It is the Lord alone who will give us victory when it comes to memorizing Scripture. And yes, we know that he will work through our diligence and even through the amazing resources that we have available to us, but it is always him who is working. So we need to make sure that we're taking specific time to implore the Lord through prayer to increase our memory and to really help us to treasure up his Word in our hearts so that we might not sin against him. And we can ask in faith because, like we've already talked about, God is faithful to answer our prayers that are in line with his will. And now for our final step in this process, let's, letter G, go. We have done the groundwork, now we simply have to get to work. And in God's good grace to us, we have help. There are several ways to do this, depending on how each of us learn. But just a quick side note before we get into that, before you attempt to memorize, I would encourage you to meditate. Meditating on your passage will help you intimately know and understand it. Now, this is not only helpful in actually memorizing, but it also produces much greater fruit, which is what we're looking for when it comes to battling our temptations. The more we fully understand what God's word says about our holiness, well, the more we're deeply grieved about our sin and the more eagerly we desire to turn from it the minute that first temptation comes knocking. Okay, so back to our options. First, I want to make sure that we realize that what might work incredibly well for your sister or your husband might prove completely unsuccessful for you, right? Please don't feel like you have to memorize scripture like your neighbor does, okay? So let's look at a couple different options and just process through how do you best tend to learn things, and let's go with that. All right, so for me, I'm a very tactile person. I have to see it, I have to feel it in order for me to really remember it and know it. So I'm all about index cards and post-it notes. So I have post-it notes on my bathroom mirror. I have index cards all around my kitchen sink because that's a place I spend a lot of time. Sometimes I keep index cards in my pocket that I can pull out throughout the day and look at. The general principle here is that we are able to see the passage that we are working on memorizing multiple times throughout the day. And we don't want to just see it, right? We want to put our eyes on it, but then we want to read it. We want to think about it. We want to try to say it without looking at it. This is a practice that I promise will produce fruit. And guys, it's not a race. Right? Don't get discouraged if you can't do it by a certain amount of time. That's not the desire, right? The desire is to store it up in your heart. God hasn't given us a time frame that we have to do that by. So please don't feel discouraged in that. Just keep going and you will see that you will be able to memorize scripture, okay? Watch how the Lord equips you. It's pretty amazing. Now, whether or not you will decide to use this method as your primary memorization tool, having strategically placed index cards with your current memory passage or passages on them is incredibly helpful. So, we have a little bundle of treasure for you ladies to help get you started on this endeavor. So for most of you on the insides here, you have a tiny bag underneath your chair there, and they have little bundles that you can grab one and pass it around. There should be plenty for everyone in the room. So, these are bundled stacks of index cards, and they have a helpful reference card on top of them. And so we have chosen that reference, we have chosen to call that reference card Treasures to Fight Temptation. And it has a helpful verse that has been specifically chosen as an offensive tool to fight off those earlier temptations that we talked about. Okay, so feel free to use what we've provided or mine out your own passages to fill your index cards. But our goal is that these will help you ladies to get started memorizing more and more scripture as you head home later today. Now, another helpful way to memorize is reciting things out loud, right? Recitation. This is what I primarily use with my children, but it's a great blessing and benefit to me in the process. So the kids and I will regularly memorize larger chunks of scripture, and we simply do that by spending a little bit of time each morning reading the whole passage together and then reciting parts of it out loud, adding on as we go. And eventually, we've stored up that whole passage in our hearts. And again, I cannot tell you how long this takes because I don't keep track. My desire is not to get it done in a certain amount of time, but to simply have that stored up in our hearts. And so eventually we get there, and then we periodically go back and touch back on those passages that, you know, we're not as fresh on anymore. Now, the last resource I want to share is phone apps. Some options to explore are Bible Memory App. This used to be Scripture Typer. It's Bible Memory App, and then the Fighterverse app. Fighterverse. So these apps are filled with loads of great ways to help you memorize, as you can quiz yourself, as you can put verses to song, even listen to your verses spoken back to you. An app is also a great way to electronically store all those verses that you have been memorizing, and you can quickly reference them later. Now, whatever resource we use and we find most helpful, we don't have to wait until scripture is fully memorized in order to put it to work. So here's how we use this. When temptation hits, we need to immediately replace the temptation with the word, right? Simply wishing tempting thoughts out of our heads will never prove victorious. I promise, I have tried it before. Paul tells us in Philippians 4:8 that we need to actively set our minds on the things that are true, and nothing is truer than God's word, as we even learned last night. So as your mind fills with a particular temptation, you begin to recite the passage that you have been working on. Now, if this temptation is particularly heavy, or if it's something that you have been ignoring for a season, this will not be a quick fix. So we need to set our expectations there. It is going to feel like work because it is work. You know, we are encased in sinful flesh, which means that our minds are going to naturally and easily wander towards temptation. Remember what we read in James. We are being lured by our own desires. So this is a mental tug of war that will happen, but the cost of losing is incredibly high. So we need to set our mind on God's word over and over and over again. And one thing that I can say as a needed encouragement, as all of us are working to tackle these temptations, is that the more quickly and regularly we turn to the word when the temptation hits, the more quickly we will see his word act. It is just like the dishes that we talked about earlier. We will soon find ourselves being delivered from temptation in 10 to 15 minutes or less of setting our minds on God's word, because he is faithful, ladies. And I trust that the Lord will use his treasured word and our faithful pursuit of holiness to continually change us into the image of his son. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, I am so thankful that you have not left us alone. God, that you have given us your word. You have given us your sure and true commandments, God, so that we can know the best way that we ought to live. God, for your glory and even for our good, because you are so kind and you have given us things that work according to your design and they are good for us. God, I pray that you would give all of us in this room, first and foremost, a great desire to flee sin, and that you would give us minds that can grasp your word, to memorize your word, to use your word as the sword that it is to fight our temptations. God, that we would be women who would sin less and less as we grow more like Christ because of our ability in your strength alone to fight the temptations that come. God, we love you so very much. We are so thankful for who you are, for the word you've provided, and we pray this in Christ's name. Amen.